very interesting talk this evening. It's probably, for most of you, I would guess, is going to be something very different, something that you've never really heard presented before, kind of unique. For some of you, might be very familiar with this, but this talk is going to do a couple things. Number one, it's going to kind of blow away the myth of facts versus faith, that skeptics are all into facts and Christians just have faith. And it's also going to train you how to defend your faith very easily without having to have advanced degrees in science and Greek and Hebrew and all those things. It's a very interesting talk. Might make your head spin just a little bit because it's different, but it's pretty easy to understand, and I think you're going to enjoy it. Some of you don't know me very well, so very quickly I will go over my background again because you probably don't know me from a hole in the ground. So that's me, and that's a hole in the ground. So there are some differences there. I was raised in a Christian home, and you can see very clearly that that is a Christian home. And I went to public schools all the way through high school. And when I graduated, I went to a Christian college, John Brown University in Arkansas, to study mechanical engineering. Partway through, I became more interested in physics, but John Brown didn't have a physics major, just a minor. So I left there and went back to Wisconsin, where I'm from, and went to the University of Wisconsin at Whitewater to get a degree in physics. And that's when my world changed quite a bit, going from a small Christian college where my engineering professors opened up every class in prayer to a large state university where my physics professors did not open up in prayer. They were all evolutionists, some of them were atheists, and they were telling me in essence that everything I believed was wrong. And that made me feel very uncomfortable to be surrounded by these PhD scientists who I assumed had a lot of evidence for what they believed, but I realized that even though I knew what I believed, I didn't know why. How did I really know that God existed? How did I know the creation account was scientifically valid? How did I know there was a worldwide flood? How did I know that Jesus was the Son of God? How did I know the Bible was the inspired Word of God? I was raised to believe all those things, just didn't know why. I couldn't defend it. So God put it in my heart at that point in my life, about my junior year of college, to start looking into these things. So I have been researching and lecturing now for the past 30 years. And about 10 years ago, I felt called into full-time ministry. I founded the Creation Education Center, been traveling around the country and actually out of the country as well. In fact, I just got back from St. Martin about 5 days ago for a week there. Kind of exciting, another story for another time, but just a very exciting, powerful ministry that God has developed. He doesn't need me. He's allowing me to be involved, but he certainly doesn't need me. But that's what I've been doing for the past 30 years, but 10 years full-time. And probably the most important thing that I learned when studying physics was this: to never trust an atom because they make up everything. Now, that's just a warning about my very, very dry sense of humor you have to put up with for a little bit. I did mention I'm from Wisconsin. It's a real state. We love our cheese and our Packers. And it gets colder. I know you guys think it gets cold here once in a while, but it gets really cold there sometimes. This is inside my car, minus 18 degrees. The wind chill was minus 44. That's really cold. Back one day we actually got 2 feet of snow. Like, I know, I warned you, it doesn't get any better than that. But it gets hot there too. This is a sign outside of where I was speaking, 107 degrees, very warm. It's actually a very beautiful place to be from. This is not my family, it's just a picture of them. My wife Amy and I, we've been married 23 years. My son Taylor is 20, he's in his junior year of college. My daughter is going to her sophomore year of college. We did a Grand Canyon tour last July. I'm doing one in 2 weeks again, and then October. In fact, very quick side note about that. How many of you have ever been to the Grand Canyon on tour? Wow, quite a few of you. That's awesome. If you haven't been there, it's a great opportunity, not just to see a big hole in the ground, but to see firsthand testimony of the authority of God's Word, Genesis flood, Genesis 6 through 8. One day, we're actually walking along the rim. You're looking 1 mile down to the Colorado River. I'm actually afraid of heights, but I figured it wouldn't be an issue because the canyon's not high. It's just really deep. And then the next day, we're on rafts on the Colorado River looking up. And then we give lectures along the way of physical scientific evidence of rapid deposition of the layers and rapid carving out of the canyon after the flood. Very powerful tour if you're interested. We're sold out for July, but we still have some room in our October tour if you want to go. You can see me afterwards, grab a card, or go to our website. We were going to use this brochure here to promote the trip. But we thought that might not get enough interest, so we're not using that one. But we have a problem today that statistics show us that 50 to 75% or more, it's probably more like 80, 85% of Christian students end up walking away from their faith before they leave college. That should be very alarming to all of us here. Half to three quarters or more of our own kids are walking away from their faith. How in the world is that possible? Well, there are a number of factors, but one of the biggest factors is that they have a set of beliefs without convictions. Kind of like me, I was taught all the right things, I just didn't know why they were the right things, and it's very easy to walk away when you get all the challenges from your professors at college, and it's part of another talk I give, I have to skip that for now. But that's why this is so important for us as Christians to not only understand what we believe, but to know why, so that we can also mentor our children. You can't give your kids something you don't have. If you're not quite sure why we believe, well, we believe the Bible because we're Christians. Why are we Christians? Because we believe the Bible. Why do you believe we believe the Bible? Because we're Christians, and round and round. How do you know God wrote the Bible? I just know. I mean, it says it is. That's what I feel, you know. Well, that's great, but how do you convince someone else just because you have a feeling, including your own children? So, again, that's part of another talk that I give, but moving on to this talk here. It deals with facts versus faith. Again, the skeptics are all about facts and proving things, where we Christians, we just have faith, right, which is nothing more than wishful thinking and rainbows and puppy dogs and fairy tales and butterflies. And even many Christians feel that way. Well, you know, it is a faith, and you just have to believe it. And so we're hesitant to share our faith because we can't prove anything and we can't really defend it, and the skeptics are all about science and testing things. So that's what we're going to take a look at here. Here are a few comments about the idea of faith from skeptics. They say faith is not a virtue. It's gullibility, dishonesty, blindness, absence of reason. Faith should not be respected. It should be detested. Then we have Sam Harris. He's one of the world's leading atheists. He said this: it's time that we admitted that faith is nothing more than the license religious people give to one another to keep believing when reason fails. Christopher Hitchens. He was one of the world's leading atheists. Died just a few years ago. He said it's called faith because it's not knowledge. And we have Richard Dawkins. You're all familiar with Richard Dawkins. He has a lot of interesting quotes. Here's just one of them. Faith is a great cop-out, the great excuse to evade the need to think and evaluate evidence. Faith is belief in spite of, even because of, the lack of evidence. These guys are not impressed with the idea of faith. And even Mark Twain said this: faith is believing what you know ain't so. We know it's not true, but we just believe it anyway. That's what faith is all about. Well, it's pretty sad commentary about faith there. But those ideas have even crept into the church. Here's a sign outside of one church that said this. It says, reason is the greatest enemy that faith has. I think that's a terrible message to be portraying to the public driving by. In fact, what does Scripture say? It says in Isaiah, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Romans 12:2 does not say, be ye transformed by the removal of your mind. It says, be transformed by the renewal of your mind. God wants us to think. Here's another sign outside another church. It said, if your faith is big enough, facts don't count. You don't have to worry about all those pesky facts. If your faith is strong enough, it doesn't matter. So you just grit your teeth a little harder. We're going to believe it no matter what. Again, a terrible message to be portraying to people driving by about what the church or Christianity is all about. Well, here's a biblical definition of faith from Hebrews chapter 11. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Now often when you're reading Scripture, something pops out at you that maybe you've never seen before. That happened to me when I was reading this. In this case, it probably should have popped out at me a long time ago. I just wasn't really paying close attention. But this is what I saw. It's not about finding evidence for our faith. This verse is telling us that our faith is the evidence. Saying faith is the evidence of things not seen. What does that mean? What it means is the fact that we have the type of faith we do, not a blind faith. The fact that we have the type of faith we do as Christians is actually evidence that God must exist because God is the one who gave us that faith. We couldn't just drum that up on our own. So the fact that we have that faith is actually evidence that God must exist. Now that's not impressive to a skeptic. It's not for them, it's for us. It's evidence for us, confidence that these things are true. I'm not going to get overly philosophical with that. We could go pretty deep with that. We're going to keep moving here for now. We're going to look at a defense of the Christian faith. There are two major elements to the Christian faith. Number one, that God exists, and number two, that you're not him. Actually, that's not the second one. The second one is that the Bible is the Word of God. Two things. God exists, and the Bible is his Word. If we could prove these two things, we'd be done. We wouldn't have to prove the creation account because the Bible says God created things. And if we've already proved that God exists and the Bible is his Word, it's got to be true. We wouldn't have to prove there was a flood because the Bible says there was a flood. We wouldn't have to prove the deity of Christ or the resurrection of Christ or any of those things because the Bible tells us all those things. But there's a problem with this approach. And here's the problem. You're not supposed to prove that God exists, and you can't prove the Bible is the inspired Word of God. Now, if you're paying close attention here, you're probably getting a little bit nervous about all this. Like, wait a minute, who is this guy? Where is he coming from? Hang in there. I'm going to continue to develop this, and you're going to see that this makes perfect sense. This is very biblical, and it's actually going to help you defend your faith. Just got to hang in there a little bit. Now, when you think about the existence of God, probably the first thing that pops into your mind is a coil of rope, right? Maybe that's just me. Here's my point, a little analogy. Let's say you go to a hardware store, and you ask for 1 meter of rope. Guy goes over to the coil, cuts off a piece, and hands it to you. This is, there you go. Then you ask him, how do I know that's a meter? He says, well, I know it's a meter because I use a tape measure. So he's appealing to a higher authority, not just his opinion. He used a tape measure. Okay? How do we know the tape measure is accurate? Well, he says, I know it's accurate because they make it in the manufacturing plant where they do it just right. He's appealing to an even higher authority now, not just his opinion or the tape measure, but the manufacturing plant where they make the things. Okay? How do I know they're doing it right in the manufacturing plant? He goes, well, I know they're doing it right there because they're using the standards that were established at the General Council of Weights and Measures in 1983, and they determined that a meter is going to be the distance light travels in a vacuum in 1/300 millionth of a second. That's actually the ultimate authority for determining how long a meter is. A meter is that distance because they said it is. That's where they determined it. It's the end of the line. You can't go any higher than that. Now, you probably follow this simple progression here. You get that. Well, with this in mind, think about this. If the Bible is truly the inspired Word of God, then it must be the ultimate authority for us as Christians. But if it's the ultimate authority, you can't prove it. It can't go any higher to use that to prove the Bible is the Word of God. It's not like there's a mega God out there over our God, and we appeal to the mega God, and the mega God says, yeah, the book you're looking at, yeah, that was written by the subservient God you guys worship. It doesn't work that way. We're at the end of the line. So if the Bible is truly the inspired Word of God, we don't go about proving it. It's our starting point as Christians. Now again, you might follow that logic so far, but you're thinking, okay, what do I do with that? I'm not quite sure where to go with that. Again, hang in there. Continue to develop that further. It's going to make perfect sense. So back to this whole dilemma, facts versus faith. Skeptics are all about facts and proven things. Whereas Christians, we just have faith. Everybody, no matter who they are, they have to start somewhere with their belief system, whether they're an atheist, a Muslim, Buddhist, Mormon, Christian. Everybody starts somewhere. We call it our starting point, our bias, presupposition, our beginning assumptions. Well, where does a skeptic say they start? Well, a skeptic wants you to think that their foundation for everything is facts. I already mentioned that. Well, you can ask the skeptic, let's say he's an atheist, what do you mean by facts? And he would say, well, you know, science, you know, proven things. Okay, what is science? Science is really the thoughts and opinions of other men and women. They look at stuff and they say, this is what we think is true. So then you can ask the skeptic, how do you know you can trust the thoughts and opinions of other men and women, most of which you've never even met? Well, I know it's true because I can just tell, I can think through these things, I can tell that they're right. So now the skeptic is using their reasoning to tell you why he can trust the thoughts and opinions of other men and women, most of which he's never met. Then I would ask him, how do you know you can trust your reason? And he would say, well, I know I can trust it because it's worked well for me throughout my life, it's been consistent. Oh. So now he's using his reason to tell you why he can trust his reason, which is circular reasoning. At that point, I would say, you know what? That's okay. Everybody's got to start somewhere. You can pick whatever you want. I just want you to understand you're really not ultimately about facts. You assume you can trust your reason, but you can't prove that. But everyone's got to start somewhere, so that's fine. I just wanted you to have a little more clarity on that. All right. What about the Christian? Where does a Christian start? Well, I already mentioned that. Christians believe that God exists and the Bible's His Word. You can't prove that. I'm not trying to prove that. I got to start somewhere. You got to pick something, and I didn't argue with you. I get to pick something too. And I believe that God exists and the Bible's His Word. And then as Christians, we believe, we base our belief and everything else rooted in this foundation. Our ideas of what science and logic are, history, philosophy, ethics, and morality, everything we believe about these things is rooted in our beginning assumption that God exists and the Bible's His Word. Now, with that, a typical defense of Christianity involves giving lectures on DNA, which I did here last time, evidences for the resurrection, Bible manuscripts, Greek and Hebrew, and all that. I've given lectures on all these things for years and years and years, 30 years. But we don't want to use evidence as proof, because evidence doesn't prove anything. In fact, science doesn't really prove anything, particularly when we're talking about the historical sciences, events that happened in the unobserved past. If they want to try to test which metal is a better conductor of electricity, yeah, I don't have a problem with them saying, okay, we've proven this one's better than that. Technically, they haven't really proven it, but yeah, okay, fine. But when we're talking about events that happened in the past, evidence certainly doesn't prove anything. They just come up with ideas about things, and if they gather a lot of very strong evidence, they say this thing is virtually certain to be true, but we don't know for sure, or they say we're almost positive this thing is not true, or somewhere in the middle. That's what we do with evidence. And here are four reasons I give in my full talk. I give seven. I'm just going to give four this evening to shorten this up a bit. Four reasons why you don't want to use evidence as proof. Number one, the skeptic might have a different interpretation of the evidence because facts don't speak for themselves. Every fact that you've ever heard or ever will hear has to be interpreted. And the way you interpret facts is by using, guess what, your starting point, your beginning assumptions. You use what you already believe to look at facts and say, well, this is what that means. For example, a Christian might look at DNA and how complex it is and say, wow, that's proof that God exists. He must have designed that because there's no way that's an accident. But an atheist looks at the exact same facts, the same DNA, and says, no, you know what? We think that's what nature does over time. You give it enough time and particles will come together and create DNA. We don't have all the answers yet, but we're working on it. We're getting closer. That's how science works. So you have two different people looking at the same facts coming up with two totally opposite conclusions. But here's where it's even more interesting. A third person, let's say another atheist, looks at DNA and says, you know what? You Christians are right. There is no way that that DNA is an accident. That thing was designed. It could never happen by accident. But it wasn't your God. It was aliens that designed it. And as silly as that sounds, you're all probably familiar with Dr. Francis Crick. He was a co-discoverer of the DNA molecule. Brilliant, brilliant scientist. That was his belief before he died. He knew how complex that was. He knew it couldn't be an accident. But he's an atheist. So it couldn't have been God, but if it was designed, it must have been someone else. So he believed in an alien somewhere else in the universe, maybe 4 billion years ago, created life in seed form, sent it to our planet on spaceships, and it grew from there. Brilliant, brilliant scientist. Believing something to us sounds kind of silly because of his starting point. He said there is no God, so he's got to come up with some answer. And we have the whole thing backwards. Most people think what you do is you look at evidence, you come to some conclusion, and you establish which worldview is correct. Which starting point is correct. No, it's just the opposite. You start with your starting point, your worldview, and you use that to interpret the evidence, and you come to a conclusion. You have to start with your starting point, or it wouldn't be your starting point. Another reason we don't use evidence as proof, we're letting the skeptic be the judge. Now, if you think about it, where do you most often hear evidence being presented? Typically in a courtroom situation. Lawyers come in, they present evidence to the judge, and then he or she gets to determine the truth of the matter. When you present evidence to a skeptic, you're letting them be the judge. But in this case, you're letting someone who doesn't think clearly be the judge. Why would I say that? I'm not trying to be condescending at all. I say that because of what we read in Scripture in Romans chapter 1. It says, for although they knew God, they neither glorified Him as God nor they gave thanks to Him. But their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. This is not name-calling. God isn't saying, oh, they're fools. God is describing their thinking process because they have chosen to reject all the information he's already given them in nature. God says, okay, see how well that works for you. He's given them over to a reprobate mind, darkened thinking, professing themselves to think clearly and wisely. They've been thinking foolishly. So now when you just give them facts and evidence, DNA, and they say, I don't think that's evidence for God, and you say, how could you not see that? Romans chapter 1 tells us why they don't see it. This is a spiritual issue, not an academic debate. They don't just need more facts. They need their starting point re-evaluated. So we got to be careful not just to think that throwing facts at them is going to change their mind. Another reason we don't use evidence as proof, it elevates science and authority over God's word. For too many years, I have told people, science proves the Bible's true. And that sounds great, but it's wrong, because that would mean that science is able to tell us whether or not the Bible is the inspired word of God. Maybe it's looking pretty good today, but maybe next week they discover something that doesn't look good at all for the Bible. Then you'd have to say, well, okay, maybe it's not the inspired word of God. And then the next month, oh, now it's looking good again. Now it is. And then now it isn't. And then now it is. And then now it isn't. Back and forth and back and forth. The whole time letting science sit in authority over God's word. It's really just the opposite. The Bible should sit in authority over science. Now, it's not a scientific textbook. We're glad it's not, because even fewer people would read it. It'd be harder to understand. And it would have to be updated and corrected constantly. But what we do use the Bible for is to properly understand and interpret astronomy and biology and geology and anthropology. The Bible should sit in ultimate authority over science, which is all about interpretation. Last example here, why we don't use evidence as proof. The skeptic already knows that God exists. There are no atheists. There never have been atheists. Now, why would I say that? You all probably know atheists. Maybe there are even atheists here tonight. If there are, that's awesome. I'm totally honored that you would come here. Why would I say this? It sounds kind of arrogant. Is it because I've read all the philosophy books and realized the authors are wrong? No. Have I interviewed all the atheists and realized that they're wrong? No. Just read God's word, and this is what he says back in Romans chapter 1. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. God is telling us that he himself has made himself plain to everybody. They all know that he exists because God is telling us that he's done that himself. Now, some of those people have chosen to reject that knowledge. And they call themselves atheists. So in that sense, there have always been atheists and there always will be atheists. But they're not people who don't know God exists. They're people who have chosen to reject that knowledge. And they call themselves atheists. So when we as Christians run around trying to prove God's existence, God's kind of saying to us, what are you doing? They already know I exist. This is not an academic debate. It's a spiritual issue, and we need to approach it that way in a lot of prayer, and we need to be very Christ-like and very gracious and patient with them, just like God has been patient with us. So again, we need to keep this in mind as we're dealing with skeptics and atheists. So we don't use evidence to prove God's existence or the inspiration of Scripture. Those beliefs are our starting point. So how do we approach a skeptic when witnessing to them? Well, I would recommend you start here in God's Word. If it's our starting point, we should start there with the skeptic. And this is what I would, again, further recommend. First of all, share what it says with the skeptic. Do not assume that the skeptic understands what Scripture claims about God. For too many years, I shared a lot of evidences for the inspiration of Scripture. Along the way, I convinced some skeptics that the Bible was really written by God. But it was depressing to them because they assumed that the Bible said that God hated them. He's just waiting for them to mess up so he can smash them over the head and send them to hell. That's how much he hates them. And it was depressing to find out, oh, I guess that's really true. First of all, share who God really is, his perfect nature, how he created us, and we were perfect. created us to have fellowship with him, but we messed it up. We rejected God, separated ourselves from God. But he loved us so much, he said, you know what, I don't want to just smash you and start over. He could have done that. But he said, no, I got a plan. I'm going to solve this thing, even though it's going to cost me the life of my own son. He's going to shed his blood to pay for the sins of the world. God went through with that anyway, because that's how much he loves us. So tell people that that's what Scripture is claiming about God, that he wants to have a relationship with them, wants to forgive them. And then after they clearly understand what it claims, whether they believe it or not, they will at least know what it's claiming for itself accurately. After that, you show how the Bible best explains the real world that they're living in. And that's what we use evidence for, because some people say at this point, oh, this is depressing. Now you're telling me I can't use evidence. I'm not saying that at all. Evidence is very powerful. We don't use it as proof because no one uses evidence as proof. But it's very powerful, and this is how. We use evidence to take these worldviews for a test drive. Let's just see how they work. That's what we're going to do with the remainder of this talk here. We're going to test these worldviews. For example, the atheistic worldview and the Christian worldview. Take them out for a test drive with three philosophical examples and then three scientific examples. Philosophical example number one. We're going to look at the idea of logic. All we're doing is we're considering what logic is and seeing how well do these worldviews handle the idea of logic. So you could ask this atheist, do you believe that logic exists? And they would say, well, of course I do. Why would you ask me that? That's kind of crazy. I say, okay, just checking. Do you believe there are laws of logic, like the law of non-contradiction? I can't both be standing here talking to you right now and not standing here talking to you right now. Do you believe there are laws of logic? And they would say, yeah, I believe there are laws of logic. Okay, are these laws physical things? Can I take them to a laboratory and bend them and paint them and weigh them? And they would say, no, they're not physical. They're non-physical. They're immaterial. Okay? Are these laws the same everywhere? Are they the same here in Southern California as they are in Wisconsin, as they are on the moon, as they are everywhere else? Or are they different in different places? And he would say, well, no, they're the same everywhere. Okay? Do they change? Will they be the same tomorrow as they are today? Were they the same 1,000 years ago as they are now, or do they change over time? And he would say, well, no, they don't change, they stay the same. Okay. So you're telling me you believe there are laws of logic that are immaterial, meaning non-physical. They're the same everywhere and they don't change. And he would say, yeah, that's what I believe. And say, okay, I got one more question for you. Where did they come from? Given your worldview, the thing that you chose as your starting point, there is no God and you can trust your own reasoning, where did they come from? Because in your worldview, the only thing that exists is matter and energy. But yet you believe in these non-physical things, these laws of logic. Well, how did matter and energy create non-physical things, these laws of logic? And what is it in your worldview that tells you you know they are the same everywhere? And using your worldview, the thing that you chose, use your worldview to help me understand, how do you know that they don't change? There's nothing in their worldview that can account for these non-physical laws of logic or why they would be the same everywhere and why they never change. Well, what about the Christian worldview? Very straightforward. How do we explain it? Christians believe in a God who himself is immaterial, non-physical. He's universal, same everywhere, and he doesn't change. That God created a universe that operates under laws of logic, which they themselves are immaterial, universal, and unchanging. It reflects his character. It fits in perfectly well with a Christian worldview, but it's totally antithetical to an atheistic worldview. In fact, an atheist, in a sense, has to assume that God exists to justify the existence of logic, to then use logic to tell us why God doesn't exist. It's kind of crazy. Did I just disprove the atheistic worldview? No, I'm not trying to do that. We're just testing it. And at this point, it's not going so well. They can't even account for the laws of logic. And if you can't account for the laws of logic, you're kind of done, because you need to use logic to talk about anything else. So that's just one test. Second test here, very quickly, absolute morality. Why is it that no matter where you go, everyone just seems to know intrinsically that murder is wrong? You can't just walk up to someone and shoot them because you don't like their hat. I mean, or torture innocent babies. I mean, you just know that that's just wrong. Why is that phenomena experienced across the globe? Yes, there are rare exceptions here and there where people have some mental issues, but everyone else, they just know, yeah, that's wrong. What would an atheist say to that? Well, they would say, well, that's how we've evolved. We've evolved to sense that, you know, murder is wrong and it helps us. Oh, evolution, yes. Okay, well, evolution, that's what? Natural selection and survival of the fittest, right? Yeah. All right, so if I, as a Christian, decide the atheists are bothering me and giving me a hard time, if I just want to wipe them out and can do that, you can't tell me I'm wrong. That's just natural selection, survival of the fittest. Well, no, you can't just kill all the atheists. That would be wrong. Well, wait a minute. That's how you believe we got here, survival of the fittest. I'm just continuing that. Why is it all of a sudden wrong? I actually talked to an atheist just a couple of days ago here locally. Really nice guy. Seriously, nice guy. We had a great conversation, but I asked him that. Why is all of a sudden natural selection wrong when for millions and millions and millions and millions of years it was a great thing because that's how we got here? But all of a sudden, I said, what are you looking at that tells you now what's wrong? No answer to that. Well, you know, it's chemicals in the brain. It's, when chemicals move a certain way, it gives you that sensation that murder is wrong. Oh, okay. If my chemicals move a different way and I want to shoot you, you can't tell me I'm wrong. It's just chemicals moving. I can't control that. Well, no, you can't do that because there's nothing in their worldview that can account for how we just know. It's just wrong. There are no absolutes there. Well, what about the Christian worldview? Very straightforward. You got the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not murder. It violates the character of God. We are created in God's image, and He's instilled in us the knowledge that murder is wrong because we're created in His image. Very straightforward, fits in very well with the Christian worldview. Why we all know that? Because we all are created in God's image. Third philosophical example, knowledge and certainty. This one gets kind of fun. You can ask the skeptic, is there anything you know for sure? And I mean absolutely certain. There's just no way you could be wrong. And he might say, well, I know I'm here right now. How do you know you're here? Because I'm talking to you. Okay? How do you know you're not just dreaming that you're talking to me? Because you're talking back to me. How do you know you're not just dreaming that I'm talking back to you? Oh, because I can pinch myself and I can feel that. How do you know you didn't just dream that you pinched yourself and felt that? You know what? None of us can actually prove we're here right now. Now, there is a lot of very, very, very strong evidence we're here, so it's very reasonable to assume, yeah, we're really here. No one doubts that. But technically, you can't actually prove it. So, further with this thought, if I told you that my next-door neighbor's oldest son was 21 years old, but I could be wrong. Do I know for sure he's 21 years old if I'm telling you, I think I could be wrong? No, I don't know for sure if I'm admitting I could be wrong. With that in mind, you ask the skeptic, out of all there is to know in the entire universe, what percentage do you think you know? He'd probably say, well, probably pretty small. I'd say, yeah, me too. But let's say they think they know maybe 1% of everything. And again, it's probably a lot more than anyone knows. But let's just say they think maybe they know 1%. Then I would ask him, is it possible, is it even remotely possible that something in the 99% that you admit you don't know, something out there would tell you that you are actually wrong about the 1% you think you know? Is it possible? And they would say, yeah, well, I suppose it's possible. Well, if it's possible you're wrong about the 1%, do you really know the 1%? No. In fact, you can't know anything for sure. Well, yeah, well, you can't either. Are you sure about that? Now, it sounds kind of juvenile at that point, but we're not trying to be juvenile. We're just carrying this out logically, this particular worldview. An atheist has to admit they could actually be wrong about everything. Well, now, there's actually a way to know something for sure, and that is if you knew 100% of everything, then there's no way you're going to learn something new to find out you were wrong about something else because you know everything. Well, that doesn't look too good for us. None of us know everything, but there's one other way you could know something for sure. And that is if you knew somebody who knew everything, and that somebody chose to tell you some of that in a way you could understand and they didn't lie about it. That is the Christian worldview. Christians believe that God exists, He knows everything, and He's told some of us that, He told us some of that, and He doesn't lie about it. A Christian can legitimately claim to know something for sure, whereas an atheist has to admit they could be wrong about everything. Did I just disprove their worldview? No, we're just testing it, and again, it's not working well at all. We're going to finish here with three scientific examples. We're going to look at the origin of the universe, the variety of life, and information very quickly, and then we might have just a few minutes for Q&A. Look at the origin of the universe. These worldviews, these starting points, make predictions about different things, including the origin of the universe. Atheistic worldview would say that everything came about through a big bang, 100% naturalistic. Christian worldview says in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Well, let's take a look at a little evidence to see which side the evidence more naturally supports or more naturally is understood or interpreted by. Well, we've got the first and second laws of thermodynamics. Again, without getting very technical at all, these are probably the best two laws we have in science. First law says, in a nutshell, you can't get something out of nothing. Matter can neither be created or destroyed. You can't get something out of nothing. Now, I know sometimes they'll talk about, oh, these particles all the time are coming in and out of nothing. There's a lot to that. They're not coming in out of nothing. In fact, you can't even know you have nothing. How do you know there's nothing there that these particles are coming out of? They already talk about dark energy and dark matter. You're out there to save the Big Bang, but they say it's undetectable. Well, how do you know there isn't undetectable energy here that these particles are coming in and out? They're just turning into a different type of energy and then back into mass and energy. You can convert energy into mass back and forth. So you can't say something came out of nothing. And our everyday experience and every scientific experiment shows us you can't get something out of nothing. Well, the Big Bang speculates that there was something that came out of nothing and then the Big Bang expanded it. So that goes against the known laws of science that we have today. And then the second law of thermodynamics basically says when you do have stuff left on its own, it goes downhill over time. Well, the Big Bang is kind of the opposite. It comes out of nowhere for no reason to begin with, and then it chaotically expands and gets more and more complex over time. That doesn't fit well with the Big Bang and naturalistic explanations. But then we have fine-tuning and the anthropic principle, and you've probably had talks about these things in more detail here. The simple point here is there's all these different factors in physics and in space and all that, and even here on the Earth, that if they aren't right where they are today, these values, life's not possible. There's tons of them. I'm going to steal some details from one of my other talks. We're just going to look at two examples, two factors out of probably a few hundred that we could look at. We have the gravitational constant and the cosmological constant. Won't go into details on what those are, but they're just values in physics that if they weren't right where they are today, life's not possible. Well, what are the chances that these two factors turned out right? Right where they needed to be by accident. Just a big bang, no God, no creator, no designer, just nature, hey, we got lucky. Well, they've calculated this. The chances that just these two out of a few hundred we could look at turn out right by accident is one chance in 100 million trillion, 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 trillion. In case you haven't studied math or science much yet, that's a big number. Here's a quote from Sir Frederick Hoyle. He was one of the world's leading atheists. He was a leading astronomer. He came to the conclusion there must be a God just by studying math and science. He's the one that gave us the term the Big Bang, but he was making fun of it at the time, and then the name stuck. But this is what he said. A common sense interpretation of the facts suggests that superintellect has monkeyed with physics as well as chemistry and biology and that there are no blind forces worth speaking about in nature. Not an accident. So those things fit very well with the Christian worldview, but again, they go totally against this whole idea of there is no God and the Big Bang happened all on its own. Second scientific test here, going quickly, the variety of life. Again, these worldviews make predictions about this, of all these creatures got here. Atheistic worldview says it all came about through evolution, which is mutations and natural selection. Christian worldview, God created all the creatures and they would reproduce after their kind. Yes, you can get a nice variety, but it's always within limits. I went into a lot more detail on this in the last talk that I gave here, but just looking at a little bit of that evidence again. Today you can breed a dog and a wolf and you get a wolf dog. That's real science. Because today you can breed dogs, dingoes, coyotes, and wolves. They're all the same kind of animal. And again, a dog and a wolf gives you a wolf dog, but what you can't breed is a dog and a hummingbird to get something that looks like that. That one's not going to happen. So modern genetics says, you know what? Scripture is pretty accurate there. Things reproduce after their kind. That's all we ever see in science. but you're not going to get a single-celled, you know, organism that slowly turns into every other life form on this planet over millions and millions of years. That's not supported by science at all. And again, this was the talk I gave here last time, evolution probable or problematic, looking at the details of DNA. And then the probabilities that I gave you came out of this talk, creation versus evolution, the case from science. Those are both up here you can look at afterwards. Last example, and we'll do just a little bit of Q&A if that's what you want to do. I've got some time if you want to do that with a meeting this evening. Information. If you're a well-adjusted human being, you use information all the time, but you don't really think about what it actually is. But we're going to look at what it actually is here and think about these worldviews here, these starting points. Again, they make predictions. An atheistic starting point says that all the information we see in living things came about by random actions of particles banging together in molecules over millions and millions and millions of years and created all this information we see. Whereas the Christian worldview says, John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word. In Greek, it's logos, which actually means word. God spoke everything into existence, and intelligence created all that information. Well, let's look at some evidence. A newspaper holds a fair amount of information using paper and ink. Books hold even more information, again, using paper and ink. A CD made out of metal and plastic holds even more information. In fact, you can hold about 100,000 pages of text on a single CD. Then we have a computer hard drive, metal and plastic, holds even more information. In each of these cases, these physical materials do a great job of storing information. But in none of these cases did these materials create the information. The paper and ink didn't write the newspaper article. It didn't write the book, you know, an author did. The metal and plastic didn't write Microsoft Office on there. A software engineer wrote it, and they're just using the materials to store the information. Within that in mind, let's take a look at DNA. DNA is also made out of physical stuff, and it does an even better job of storing information. So we'll look a little bit at storing capacity of DNA, and we'll start out looking at the volume of DNA. A typical human adult has about 100 trillion cells in their body, and each one of those cells, except for red blood cells, have DNA in the nucleus there. And if you went into just one cell in your body, like a cell in the tip of your finger, and you pulled that DNA out, it would be about 6 feet long, but super, super, super thin. But it's got all the information to develop your whole body and help you function as an adult. In fact, the DNA in that cell, in the tip of your finger, could make an eyeball there, or heart, or pancreas, or anything. All that information there is there, but it knows just to make a finger cell there because of what's going on, how complex it is. But all the information is there on each single, you know, strand of the DNA out of the nucleus here. So how much volume, how much space does that strand of DNA take up in a single cell that has all the information to make up your whole body? Well, the amount of volume it takes up is this, 0.000, I think they're like 17003 cubic meters. That's really, 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 really tiny. And yet all that information is on there. Here's another analogy. The book that I wrote has about 300 pages in it. You could fit over 5,000 copies of my book on just one strand of DNA from one cell in your body. Storage capacity is amazing. One other quick example. Let's look at just a pinhead amount of DNA. How much information could be stored in the pinhead? Well, I already mentioned a single CD can hold 100,000 pages of text on it. That's a lot of information. A thumb drive, 2 gig thumb drive, can hold 3 entire CDs. So that's 300,000 pages of text on a little tiny thumb drive like that. Well, now we have portable thumb drives. A 2 terabyte thumb drive or hard drive can hold 1,000 thumb drives. And that 2 terabyte hard drive is roughly the size of my Bible here. It's pretty small. That's a lot of information in a small space. Well, let's compare the information on this 2 terabyte hard drive to just a pinhead amount of DNA. You could store 2 million hard drives in a pinhead amount of DNA. It's absolutely amazing. So what does that fit better with? I think it fits very well that a supernatural God created all that information in that information storage system versus particles banging together over time. We've never seen anything in science where particles bang together and create information. So again, did we just disprove their worldview? No, just testing it again. Once again, it's just not looking well at all. So all we did here is we took these worldviews out for a test drive. And we found that the Christian worldview that starts with the existence of God and the Bible is really the only one that makes sense of the world around us. So what you can do is you can tell the skeptic or the atheist, you are free to believe whatever you want, use whatever starting point you want. But if you don't start out with a Christian worldview, you're going to have problems over and over and over and over. So it's not about twisting their arm or judging them. It's just getting them to think a little more clearly about what they're using to evaluate all the evidence. Instead of just throwing more facts at them, and they're going to continue to interpret it differently and wrongly because of their wrong starting point. And again, we want to do this very graciously. We're doing this not so we can make them look foolish and win an argument. We're doing this to help them more clearly understand God's word and the power of the gospel message, because that's what it's all about. It's not about proving that creation is true or showing that evolution isn't true. Even if you show evolution not to be true, that doesn't mean that the Bible's right. We need to take it a step further and talk about the authority of God's word and tell them that we're praying for them and that we're more than willing to talk to them anytime they want to. We're not going to shove it down their throat, but we're there for them, and we're doing this because we care. If we don't share these things with the skeptic, it says one of two things. Either number one, we don't really believe it ourselves. We're not quite sure that God exists or that Jesus is the only way or the Bible's his word. We're not quite sure about that, so we don't bother telling them. Or we don't really care about them. We know the truth. We're not going to bother telling them because we don't care about them. But if you do care, you're going to tell them no matter how they respond, even if they hate you or laugh at you. We don't care so much about that. We want to tell them to give them an opportunity to make a decision about it rather than finding out, you know, I'll close with this. Not that it will carry out this way, but think about it this way as an analogy. And I want you to each think of somebody you know right now that you are convinced they are not a Christian, they are not saved. Might not know that for sure. We can't really know their heart, but for all other instances, you're just almost positive there's no way they're a Christian. They're claiming they're an atheist or whatever. I want you to think of someone specifically right now, and I want you to picture that for some reason a freak accident happens and you both are killed at the same time. And now you're standing in line before the gates of heaven. Again, I'm not saying it's physically playing out this way, but you're standing in line and your friend is ahead of you. And you finally get up to the front and your friend faces God. And God looks at your friend, looks him in the eye and says, why should I let you into my heaven? And your friend says, well, I wasn't the best person and I maybe didn't really go to church all that much, whatever. But I mean, you know that I tried. You know my heart. I tried to be a good person and I tried to work hard. I provided for my family and it's not like I was in drugs and stuff and murdered anybody. And God looks at them and says, depart from me into everlasting torment. I never knew you. And their head goes down and they walk off. And then you're next. God looks at you and says, why should I let you into my heaven? And you say, I certainly don't deserve to be here, but you know what? You sent your son to die on a cross. He shed his blood to pay for my sins. And I accepted that free gift to have my sins forgiven. And God says, enter into eternity. You start walking in. Your friend turns around and goes, whoa, wait a minute. Where are you going? Well, I'm going into heaven. How did you get in? Well, I placed my trust in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of my sins. You knew that that was the solution and you never told me? What kind of friend were you? Well, I didn't want you to think I was judging you or make you feel bad, or I didn't want you to laugh at me. Do we really care? Should we, you know, do we care about risking that if they laugh at you? I don't care if they laugh at me at all. It's not about us. It's about them and their eternity and sharing the truth that God has helped us graciously see. So we want to share these things and we want to be firm in our faith so we're more confident when we're sharing that gospel message. What we've just looked at here is actually called presuppositional apologetics. I didn't tell you that right away because you might have run out of here and go to watch paint dry. It sounds more interesting. But what this is about is using our presuppositions, things we believe to begin with that you can't prove, things that we believe to begin with, our starting point, to defend our faith, the apologetics. That's what this is all about. And we'll do Q&A if you want to for a few minutes here, but very quickly just highlight resources that I brought along here. This is really about the ultimate authority of Scripture. And God doesn't say, you know what, if you get a chance, maybe look into some of this. He commands us to be ready with an answer, reason for the hope that we have. Do it with meekness and respect so that our kids don't walk away, so that we're better positioned to share the gospel message. So we need to equip ourselves. There's tons of great resources. You guys have this awesome museum that's right here in your area. You can come to any time. You can invite your friends and neighbors to come here to see the truth of God's word. There are all these evidences here that make the Christian faith very reasonable. So there's tons of great resources right here. This is what I brought along very quickly. Some of them that they carry here at the museum. They're also available on the web. We've got 9 individual DVDs that were all recorded in a professional TV studio. In fact, many of you probably know Eric Hovind. He did the camera work on the DVDs. So 9 individual titles, including this one. We called it Faith is Not a Four-Letter Word. That's the exact talk you just saw here, the white one here. Then there's other talks. The DNA one is the one I gave last time. A bunch of other topics here. Evidence for the inspiration of Scripture. Then we have a 12-session seminar series. We took information from 5 of the 9 DVDs, shortened up the talks, made 12 half-hour talks, put a study guide inside that has discussion follow-up questions. That's available. The book that I wrote came out about a year and a half ago, and I've got a lot of great feedback on that. Master Books has published that. We have 7 pocket-sized booklets, which I ran out here, so I don't have these available, but smaller versions of Carbon-14 dating, if God created the universe, who created God, dinosaurs, Big Bang, inspiration, Scripture. That information is in the book. Then we have a monthly email newsletter. Just once a month I send it out. It's supposed to come out tomorrow because it's July 1st, but I'm here and haven't written it yet. But each month I tackle a really different, really tough question. Last month's was, should you take the Bible literally? Interesting question, and the answer isn't as straightforward as you think. And Christians need to think through this stuff. So that was last month. Then this month, meaning June, I think it was, how do you know who to believe? I won't explain that right now. I won't take the time to do that. But I always come up with a really intriguing, interesting question, and I answer it briefly in an article in the newsletter. Then if something comes out in the news, you know, they discover these gravity waves, it's proof of the Big Bang, and you're like, gravity what? I'll have an article on it saying, no, this is actually what they found. No, it's not proof of the Big Bang. It's actually a problem, and here's why. You'll see our speaking schedule and a bunch of other things. So that's available. You can either sign up on a clipboard here and go right to our website and sign up, which you'll see in a second. And very quickly, I've been speaking for 30 years. I've never charged a penny and never will. The main way our ministry moves forward is through our monthly supporters. We're a nonprofit organization, so it's all tax deductible, but it's totally between you and God. But for people who become monthly supporters, we actually give them a free set of our DVDs and a free copy of my book, not just as a thank you, but as a great set of resources to strengthen their faith, to mentor their own children, grandchildren, and then to reach out to friends and neighbors, you know, with evidence for the gospel message as well as all the other science stuff. So that's available. You can see me afterwards if you're interested. And then you can help us get connected speaking other places, which Jason helped me while I was here. I came in on Saturday, spoke at Calvary Chapel Santee because he goes there, got me connected there. It does not pay for me to cold call churches. It just does not work. Pastors don't want to give the pulpit up to someone they don't really know. I wouldn't if I was a pastor, but because Jason connected me there, I talked with them, and they found out I spoke at a lot of other Calvary Chapel churches and many others, so I got my foot in the door there. You can help us get connected as well if you know other places. You can fill out our form we have on the table. You can put your contact information on the top half of the form. And then whatever church it is that you know, all you have to do is put ABC Church wherever, Utah. Maybe you used to live in Florida or Utah or Texas or Colorado, so you know the pastor there, or you have an uncle or a nephew that's a pastor at a church somewhere, you know them. All we ask you to do is contact the person you know and ask them if they would accept my phone call. That's all you have to do. You don't have to give me their phone number, their address, their social security number, their blood type, none of that. Just say, I know a church in Utah. Fill out the form, turn it in. We will follow up with you and just say, hey, when do you think you could call your uncle or your former pastor and ask for permission for me to call? Then when I call, I will answer all the questions. You don't have to defend our ministry and explain all the details. Just say, could Jay call you? And they say yes. Then you contact me and tell me their name and number. So that form is available at our table. That really helps open up doors. I already mentioned Grand Canyon trip. It's available in October. And our website is CEC as in Creation Education Center, and then WISC as in Wisconsin, CECWISC.com. bunch of free articles that I've written, video clips, our speaking schedule, Grand Canyon details, all those things are up on the website. You can stay in touch with us that way. But again, you've got a great local resource here as well, and encourage you again to invite other people here, because don't take it for granted. Most areas in the country don't have a museum they can bring someone to, so this is about as easy as it gets. So with that, if we want to do a few minutes of Q&A, we can do that. This is my favorite part, because I get tired of hearing me speak. So if you want to ask some questions for a few minutes, we can do that, and then I'll be around a few minutes afterwards to answer any other questions or talk about resources or something. So yeah, we could probably just turn the lights back on. And so we can do this. Ask whatever question you want. Ask it loud enough for me to hear. I've actually lost a fair amount of hearing in my left ear. Don't know what's going on. I give lectures on the ear, and so I know how it all works, but I don't know what's malfunctioned. But just ask whatever question you have. I'll repeat it to make sure everyone else heard it, and then I'll try to be relatively brief in answering it so we can get to as many as possible in just a few minutes here. So who's got the first question? Okay, how about the second question? In the back. Well, the question about the age of the earth, you know, when you talk to the skeptics, the geologists, astronomers, or even Christians who believe that God used the Big Bang and all that, and there, I know many of them, and I always say I do not doubt their sincerity. I certainly don't doubt their intelligence, and I really don't doubt their salvation. Their salvation is based on their faith in Jesus Christ, not on their opinion of the age of the earth. However, what we believe about the age of the earth, as you probably know, determines how we interpret some key passages of Scripture, including the flood. You know, the vast majority of Christians who believe in the Big Bang don't believe in a global flood. And then you got the whole problem of the gospel message. The gospel message is premised on Adam's sin bringing death and a curse into God's creation. But if God used the Big Bang, that means that you had death and disease and suffering for millions and millions of years before Adam's even here, and all those issues. I'm sure you're very, very familiar with all that. So what are these skeptics or the other Christians do when you give them some of these evidences? Well, again, they're going to just interpret it differently. They'll work really hard. They come up with what we call rescuing devices, a way to somehow explain away the evidence to save their worldview. That's what they do with finding soft tissue and red blood cells and dinosaur bones and all those types of things. They say, wow, I guess there's something out in nature that somehow can preserve red blood cells for millions and millions of years. Now, there's nothing in known science that backs that up, but they will not give up their millions of years of ages, because that would totally destroy their belief in evolution. So that's just never going away. They were always believing that. And it's really, really easy to make fun of Christians with six-day creation. I mean, that's silly. Yeah, right. God created all this in 6 days. Oh, yeah, dinosaurs were around when people were around, and everyone just laughs. Super easy to make fun of people with that, unless they take the time to listen to these things. And I always tell people, if you've got some time, I'd love to share with you. If you don't, it's going to sound crazy. I totally get that. Not because of much of anything they actually know, just because of what they've been taught, kindergarten on up. Dinosaurs died out 65 million years ago, radiometric dating, on and on and on. When you hear that over and over and over and over and over, and then someone else comes along and says, well, actually, that's not true. It's like someone coming and telling you, there's actually no moon. I know you think there's a moon. I know you think we landed on it, but it really doesn't exist. I would expect someone to think I was crazy if I said that. That's similar if they hear me say that I don't think the Earth is billions of years old. I expect that they think I'm a nut job. But if I had even 20 minutes to share just a few things, I'm not saying they would change their mind right away, but they'd probably say, wow, I didn't know any of that before. That's really interesting. I kind of see why you might believe that. But that's what it comes down to. No matter what evidence, whether it's helium leaks and zircon crystals, Earth's magnetic field, dinosaur bones with carbon-14, and all these other things, they're just going to try to interpret it differently. Oh, it's contamination. Oh, they got preserved. Oh, this, oh, that. Because they don't want to give up their starting point. And so it's a spiritual issue, even with Christians. I try to convince Christians more so scripturally why there's a problem, rather than just throwing more science at them, because they're going to try to counter that all the time. But if I say, just from the scripture, look at what God is actually saying. There are big problems if you try to import millions and billions of years into Scripture. If the Holy Spirit can convict them of that, then they might look at the science differently and be willing to consider that. But if you just try to focus on the science, thinking that that's impressive and that's what we need to do, probably won't be too effective. Another question.
They don't throw something out there and see if it sticks. I think it doesn't matter. Everybody believes it anyway. And I don't understand why everybody believes.
Yeah. This is a key point he's bringing up, that Christians have to prove creation. You know, if you believe in creation of the Bible, prove it, you know, right away. And we get defensive. We try to think of our best arguments. But if someone's asked about evolution, they don't have to prove it. It's the default. It's the default view, primarily because of our educational system. The vast majority of people, including Christians, go up through the public school system learning all about evolution, Big Bang, and all that. It's just a given. All the scientists know that they've proven it. So there's no reason for an individual to get defensive about it. They've got all the scientists behind them. But if you believe something counter, you're the one who's got to come up with evidence for it. And here's just some practical advice I would give you. And God has helped me focus on these very practical things more and more and more, rather than trying to teach everyone the details of DNA and all these things that can get a little complex and detailed, so you're probably going to forget some of those details. Here's just some practical things. I'm going to look very quickly at a typical conversation between a skeptic and a Christian. And you might relate to this happening. The skeptic says, evolution's a fact and the Bible's just myth. Typically then what the Christian does, they get defensive and they jump right in and try to prove their thing. Well, no, creation's true and the Bible's the inspired word of God. And the skeptic says, fine, prove it. Like, give me one fact, just one fact that proves that creation is true or the Bible's the inspired word of God. And then the Christian says, well, yeah, I don't know that I can actually prove it, but that's what I believe. Skeptic says, yeah, that's what I thought. You have your nice little fairy tale belief, but I live in the real world with science, and we prove things, and we invent things and cure diseases, and they walk off. And the Christian's frustrated. It's like, I don't know what to say. It is kind of a faith. You have to put your trust in it, where the skeptics always seem to be talking about science, and it's intimidating. Okay, that can be pretty typical. Let's revisit this conversation, but we're going to change how the Christian responds. And it's going to be very simple. All the Christian is going to do this time is simply ask questions. Anybody can do that. The only thing it requires is that you actually listen to the skeptic, which is a skill I had to learn. When I was younger, I was always very polite. The skeptic would be talking. I'm not really even paying attention. I'm just waiting for them to finish so I can tell them all my wisdom and show them how wrong they are. Doesn't work. Not a good process. So, here's the conversation again. The skeptic makes the same claims. Evolution's a fact, the Bible's just myth. This time the Christian says, ask a question. How do you know evolution's a fact? Because they made that claim. So you're just asking to find out, how do you know that's true? Evolution's a fact. How do you know evolution's a fact? Well, because all the scientists believe it. Okay, you ask another question. How do you know all the scientists believe it? Well, all the real scientists believe it. Okay, how do you define a real scientist? Well, anyone who believes in evolution, they're a real scientist. So there's some circular reasoning going on there. Then you ask them, why do you think the Bible's just myth? Well, it's filled with errors and contradictions. Okay, could you give me some examples? Well, come on, there are tons of them. Okay, then it should be pretty easy to give me an example or two. Well, I can't think of any right now, but okay. Can you tell me what the Bible is all about? From cover to cover, not all the details, but it starts with this, this goes on, that happens, and it ends with that. 30-second overview. Well, it's been a while since I looked at it. Okay, tell me, if you can't tell me any actual errors or contradictions in the Bible, and you can't even tell me what it's all about, why do you have such a strong opinion against it? Are you sure you're not just repeating what you've heard from others rather than your own well-thought-out reasoning? And you do that very graciously. What you've just done is you've gotten the skeptic to realize they're making a lot of very bold claims. It's what we call truth claims. They're claiming something is true, and all you're trying to do is understand where they're coming from. You care about them. You want to better understand their mindset. How did you arrive at those conclusions? What is it that makes you so confident in that? And they're going to realize pretty quickly they've got almost nothing to back it up. And then they might say, well, yeah, but you believe that God created everything in 6 days in this little mythical garden in Adam and Eve and all that. And then you can say, you know what? I actually haven't said anything about what I believe. You've made some bold claims, and I'm just trying to understand that better. That's how we should probably start with them, to show we care. We are listening to them. And don't let them get away with just saying, well, evolution's a fact. Yeah, no, and you want to do it extremely graciously, and don't get argumentative. If they say, question you all, you do believe that God created everything, or you do believe the Bible, and you'd say yes, and they say, well, why do you believe it? We should probably have some reasons at that point. And as a whole other talk, maybe sometime I'll come back and give my talk on how do we know the Bible is the inspired word of God. It's really, really cool. But we should have some basic outlines of reasons of why we believe the Bible. We don't need to defend God's word. That might sound strange, but here's why. The reason we don't need to defend the Bible is the same reason you don't need to defend a lion. You just let it loose and it defends itself. What we do want to defend is our choice to believe what it says. We should have some reasons as to why we believe it. We're not actually defending God's word directly. We're defending our choice to believe it. When you share scripture, it can defend itself. And there's a lot of things, a whole other talk on that. But that's a good point you brought up. We get defensive. We have to prove our side, where they just have the default version of it's true unless we can disprove it. Any other questions? Sure. When I said that with a skeptic, I would start with scripture. This is, in a nutshell, what I would do. I would first tell them, let's say we're talking to an atheist. I would tell them, I'm going to tell you something very quickly about the Bible. Now, I know you don't believe God exists, so you certainly don't think that the Bible is the inspired word of God. I get that, so you don't need to say anything. But just let me tell you what the Bible is claiming so that you're sure you understand it accurately. In fact, the atheist that I met with, I'm not even going to put out his name right now, but you can pray just for the atheist that I met with. I think God's got his number. nice guy. We had a great conversation. Both of us are just itching to talk further, but he lives here and I live in Wisconsin. I got to fly home tomorrow, but we're going to stay in touch. But I told him at the end of, we had about a 3-hour conversation a few days ago, and I told him, I said, you know what, I'm a Christian, so I believe that the Bible is the inspired word of God. So I believe everything in it is true. So I said, you know what? I'm kind of pigeonholed. I have to live in this box. I can't choose to say, well, I think, yeah, this is true, but I don't believe this. And I like, although then I become the ultimate authority. I choose, pick and choose what I think is true or not. If I really believe this, then I have to stick with what it says. And what I told this atheist was, this Bible is telling me that God does exist. So I'm stuck there. I have to believe that God exists. And in fact, very quickly, what started this at the end of our conversation, we were talking about quantum mechanics and a bunch of other stuff that I knew we were getting down into the weeds, and I knew that's not where the argument is. But at the end, when I had to leave, he asked me, he goes, well, why do you believe in God? And what's a little tiny more background, it's all so fascinating. I had a radio interview with him earlier this year, and in the interview, he said there's no scientific evidence for the existence of God. He said, that's why I'm an atheist. There's no scientific evidence for the existence of God. And I asked him in the interview then, I said, oh, what would you accept as scientific evidence for the existence of God? What would that look like if you saw A, B, or C? Yeah, that would count as scientific evidence. He goes, oh, well, and he started talking, and I had to stop him very politely. I said, wait a minute, you're talking philosophically right now. I asked for scientific evidence because you said there was no scientific evidence, so I'm asking you, what would the scientific evidence have to look like for you to say, well, that would count? He goes, oh, scientific evidence. Started talking again. He never answered the question. And the reason I asked that was not just trying to corner him, but I wanted him to realize he can't answer the question. And if he doesn't have criteria that he uses to judge what counts and what doesn't, we can't even have the conversation. So the point was, he's got no rationale that there's no evidence for the existence of God. With that backdrop, we're finishing our conversation of about 3 hours, and he asked me, why do I believe in God? And I say, well, I said, there are a lot of reasons, but clearly, very clearly, the biggest reason I believe in the existence of God is that because I believe that God, first of all, is a spirit. He's not a physical being. He's a spirit being. And it says in the Bible that God's spirit confirms in my spirit. He created me in his image. Now, since God isn't a physical being, he doesn't have hands and legs, so what does it mean that I'm in his image? Partially is that I'm a spirit being too. I have a spirit to me, not just a physical body. And the Bible says that his spirit confirms with my spirit that he actually exists. So I can know that I know that I know that these things are true. Now, I told him, I said, I am not telling you this to impress you. This is not for you. That's for me. To be confident in my faith, God's Spirit himself confirms in my spirit that these things are true. So I honestly know that I know that I know. I'm so confident, not because of an intellect, but because of the spiritual nature of that. I said, that's why I believe that God exists. And then when I look at the physical world around me, everything is consistent with what God's telling me in his word. I was like, you know what? Well, the Bible explains it. That makes sense. Well, I see this and that explains that. Very quickly here as well. I was in Pittsburgh a couple weeks ago, and I was recording 4 television programs, and one of them is a brand new talk. I've never given it anywhere. It's called, I'm calling it Surprise, the Bible Explains That. And the premise is scientists are discovering things recently that are puzzling to them, like, wow, we didn't expect that, but it's like, hey, surprise, the Bible explains that. One very, very, very quickly. Standard story. Earth forms 4.5 billion years ago. And cools down, solid rock, and then over millions and millions of years later, comets are hitting the Earth, bringing ice, and it's melting, and the oceans develop millions of years later. So Earth first, oceans millions of years later. Well, just a number of months ago, secular scientists have discovered evidence that it looks like water has been here from the very beginning. Surprise, the Bible explains it. Genesis says that God created the Earth covered with water on day one. 2 Peter chapter 3, Peter says that God created the earth out of water and by water. It's been here from the very beginning. That's what they're discovering. Surprise, the Bible explains that. So I told the atheist, I believe that God exists because of his spirit confirming that with me, but then when I look at the real world around me and I see facts and science, I can interpret them very naturally from what God tells me. So when I'm talking to a skeptic, I start with God's word and I tell them, the Bible says that God exists. He's always existed. Psalm 90, verse 2. He's always been here. He always will be here. He didn't come from anywhere. No one created him. So if the atheist asks, well, who created God? You could say, good question. The Bible says no one created him. He's always been here. Now, there's a further answer to that. I got to skip that for now. But I would tell the skeptic, the Bible says that God exists. Then I would say Romans chapter 1, he's also further told us that he's put enough evidence just in his creation to make it more than obvious he exists. He's confirmed in every human being the knowledge of his existence. That's what the Bible tells me. I have to believe that. So I have to believe that you already know that God exists. Now I know what you're thinking. No, I don't know that God exists. I know he doesn't exist. I know you think that, but God's word is telling me you already know that. So I have to go with that. I can't say, well, you know, you're saying you don't believe that, so maybe that portion's wrong. No, that's got to be true. That's what God is telling me. Then I would tell him, very graciously, God's word tells me that anyone who comes to God must come to him on his terms, not ours. A lot of skeptics say, well, you give me enough facts, you can prove God to me, then I'll believe in him. Well, you're proving it. It's not belief. Hebrews 11 says those who come to God must come to him believing that he exists, in believing that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Those are God's terms. So if a skeptic is waiting for all the facts to line up, sorry, not going to happen, because those are not God's terms. God's terms are believed by faith, and he'll confirm that with him. So I told a skeptic, I said, those are God's terms. If you're willing to do that, that's fine. If not, there are going to be issues here, because the Bible further says that the skeptic is spiritually blinded because they've rejected all this knowledge that we've already referred to in this talk. They're not going to see things clearly. So I don't expect him to make sense of everything that I'm sharing, because it's spiritually discerned. If he's willing to open up his will to the existence of God, God can work with that. But if it's going to be a head knowledge thing, not going to happen. He told me in the meeting he would love it if God existed. He said, how exciting would that be? A lot more exciting than nothing. He just doesn't see the evidence. And I said, you know what? That's awesome. If you are sincere, God can work with that. If you're really wanting to see evidence of God, he'll work with that. He'll start removing the blinders. when I get a hold of him later, I'm going to tell him, I think you're going to make an awesome Christian. I think he really will. So be praying for him. Anyway, that's a little bit of where I would start with Scripture. Even though they're not accepting that, I'll close with this. Whether, in fact, someone's got to decide when we have the last question, because although I'll go to 2 in the morning. But the Bible tells us that God's word will never return void. This is very, very important. The Bible conversely does not say, if you can tell people about DNA and how complex it is, that's going to convert them. It doesn't say that at all. Again, they're going to interpret it differently. So don't think, you know, you had some brilliant argument that's going to work for you. It says that his word will not return void. There is so much power in sharing actual scripture. Whether they think they believe it or not, there's power going out. And here's how. The scripture will either be used to convict and convert the person, which would be awesome, or it will later be used to condemn them. They heard the truth and they rejected it. Either way, it's going to accomplish God's purpose. And it's not up to us to determine which side it is. It's up to the individual whether they're going to submit their will to God or not. It's only our job to share the scripture. The Holy Spirit does all the hard work. And so work on interjecting scripture as much as you can. Even if they say, well, I don't believe that. Say, that's fine. I just want you to hear this because you know power is going out. In fact, this guy, we were going back and forth for 3 hours. I didn't sense that he was weakening at all with any of the science stuff we were talking about. But when I was quoting scripture at the end, he was like a deer in the headlights. I thought, this is cool because it's God's word and not mine. So with that, I hope that was encouraging, and I'll probably cut it off there. I've gone long enough, but I will close in a quick word of prayer, and I'll be up here afterwards if you have any additional questions. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this time we've had to look at the authority of your word, and I just pray for each person here this evening that their faith would be greatly strengthened and that they'd be better positioned to share more confidently the gospel message with a lost and dying world. And then if anyone happens to be here tonight, God, they're very skeptical. They have a lot of great questions. I'm just thankful that they are here. I pray that tonight would be the night that they would submit their will to you, place their trust in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of their sins, and then they can spend the rest of their life figuring out some of these other interesting issues, but that they wouldn't put off the issue of salvation any longer. And we just thank you for the graciousness and patience you show each one of us each day, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.